next speaker is Dr. Stephanie Tagliatella, co-founder and chief scientific officer of Encoded. Dr. Tagliatella will be providing an overview of their preclinical data for an AAV-mediated gene therapy for Angelman syndrome using their unique technology that focuses on gene expression.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Stephanie Tagliatella. I'm co-founder and chief scientific officer at Encoded Therapeutics, and I'm really thrilled to be here. It's an honor to be included in this panel of really impressive speakers. And today I'm really excited to talk with you about an approach that we've been pursuing at Encoded for a vectorized microRNA to unsilence the paternal copy of UBE3A in Angelman. These are my disclosures. So at Encoded, our mission is to unlock the full potential of gene therapy by harnessing the power of gene regulation. We are a privately owned gene therapy company. We're based in South San Francisco, California. And we've developed a vector engineering platform that looks to optimize all of the genomic components of AAV vectors in order to improve safety and potency. And our initial focus is on AAV, as this is the in vivo viral vector that's demonstrated the most clinical validation. In theory, this platform is applicable to any RNA or DNA-based therapy. So we have optimized across a number of different parameters here, many of the things that you've heard about over the course of the past couple of days, but these include things like enhancer and promoter regions, and I'm just gonna see if this pointer will work, probably. Okay, no. Including the enhancer and promoter elements that are illustrated here in blue, different effector genes, so different isoforms of transgenes, as well as DNA binding proteins and transcription factors, as well as elements in the 3' region of the gene or the downstream region of the gene that can also contribute to potency and selectivity. We are primarily focused on pediatric CNS disorders, and our lead program is focused on SCN1A positive Dravet syndrome, and we'll be entering the clinic next year. So we sought to develop a vectorized microRNA approach to unsilence the paternal UBE3A allele. AAV gene therapy, as we've been hearing throughout the day, has demonstrated pretty remarkable clinical benefits in diseases, in CNS diseases, diseases like SMA and others. And combine that with some of the really exciting work and clinical progress in that ASOs have made in unsilencing the paternal allele. And so what we've designed here is an AAV construct. It's comprised of a microRNA sequence, which here you can see is depicted in both green and purple, as well as regulatory elements that drive expression of that delivery system. This construct is packaged into an AAV capsid and delivered to the brain. As with many of these genetic therapies, they are delivered into the CSF space with a one-time administration. And we have extensive experience with the ICV route of administration, which is a highly clinically utilized route of administration to access the CSF in the clinic based on our experience with Dravet syndrome. Once this particle is delivered to the brain, the microRNA is processed into a short single-stranded RNA sequence that has the capacity to bind to a target and knock down or silence its expression. So we wanted to understand if this type of approach would be capable of binding to the UBE3A antisense transcript and unsilencing or unmasking UBE3A expression from the paternal allele. So first we developed a vectorized microRNA construct that was targeting the mouse antisense transcript. We've demonstrated in mice that we can see with an ICV administration knockdown of the antisense, which you can see here in green, compared to the untreated Angelman mice in light blue. And what we also see is that there is a microRNA sequence that is not targeting the Angelman or the antisense transcript in purple, and that is unaffected. So that gives us confidence in this result. We also see that we're able to achieve upregulation or unsilencing of UBE3A in the mouse model. And this is measured both by RNA in the upper panel as well as with protein measurement. Another way to look at this is when we stain those brain sections and we stain them for UBE3A protein. And as you can see in the Angelman mice that are untreated, you see very low levels of UBE3A protein as you would expect. And we're able to induce broad expression throughout the brain with this vectorized microRNA approach. This approach also results in a rescue of multiple phenotypes in the mouse model. So we've looked at body weight, and we can see correction of body weight with our antisense-targeted microRNA construct, as well as a rescue of the hypoactivity phenotype that's present in the mouse model, which is measured in the middle panel in an assay called open field. We've also seen our microRNA approach rescue a seizure sensitivity assay, and we can see that is present in the Angelman mice that have been treated with our antisense, but not in the scramble control. So this data was pretty encouraging. We're able to rescue phenotypes in the mouse. But we know that achieving broad biodistribution and getting this type of effect in a larger species would be challenging. We also know that the antisense transcript is actually not well conserved. The sequence is very different in the mouse and the primate. And so in parallel with this work, what we did was we developed a number of human candidates, candidates that were targeting the human antisense sequence, and tested them in human-derived induced pluripotent neurons in vitro. And so here, what you can see is we tested about 70 different candidates, and we identified about 6 that showed robust upregulation of the paternal UBE3A allele. So what we're looking at here is what's called allelic frequency. So this is essentially the ratio of paternal UBE3A to total UBE3A. And as you would expect, in the upper bar, the untreated condition shows very low levels of paternal UBE3A expression. But in a number of these candidates, we're able to shift that fairly robustly with our top candidate, candidate 1, showing nearly complete unsilencing of the paternal allele in this in vitro model. So as I had mentioned, we anticipated that seeing this type of effect in an in vivo system might be very challenging. So in the next experiment, what we wanted to understand is whether this approach was capable of knocking down the antisense and upregulating UBE3A in a non-human primate, which has the same sequence homology as the human. So for this experiment, we actually delivered our candidate via a direct intracortical injection. So this is not achieving widespread biodistribution, but it really allowed us to do 2 things. First, it allowed us to understand under conditions where you have a very high concentration of your drug, you know, can we see knockdown of the antisense and upregulation? And that would give us confidence that this approach has potential and translates into an in vivo setting. The other thing that it allowed us to do, the second thing it allowed us to do, is understand the relationship between the levels of knockdown that you need of the antisense transcript to start to see unsilencing of UBE3A. And so on the panel here on the left, what you can see is that compared to vehicle, what we saw was a really nice dose-dependent decrease in the antisense expression. So in regions that have high exposure to the drug or high vector copy number, which is denoted here as VCN, we start to see that that transcript level start to come down. We also see that that correlates with both upregulation of the paternal allele of UBE3A, as well as total UBE3A. So this provides, you know, very promising proof of concept. We've also seen this translate into protein. So when we measure total UBE3A protein, we can see that there's about a total of 20% increase in bulk UBE3A protein as compared to the wild-type animals. And this is illustrated in a more quantitative assay on the left, as well as spatially on the right, which you can see is the level of UBE3A protein in this wild-type animal is increased near the region of injection, and that co-localizes nicely with the presence of our microRNA, which is illustrated in the panel below. So I think we, taking a step back, I think this provided us with confidence that there's potential for a microRNA-based, AAV-based approach to engage with the antisense transcript and unsilence UBE3A. But we knew that we needed to increase the potency of this in order to achieve a more broader biodistribution. So in parallel with this work, we've been optimizing our candidates to improve on both potency and selectivity. And here what we'd like to share is that we have enhanced potency of some of our next generation candidates. On the left, we have our human candidate one. This is the candidate that we tested in non-human primates, showing that we can upregulate paternal UBE3A in a dose-dependent manner. And the more recent candidates that the team has discovered show a much higher capacity to increase UBE3A at the same dose level. So dose level three is what's illustrated across all of these candidates, and you can see that we're seeing a much higher level of unsilencing at these lower dose levels that reach very close to the ceiling of 50-50 ratio between maternal and paternal. Another way to look at that is to understand the actual dose differences that we're seeing here. So the highest dose tested in this experiment for our human candidate one was about 10,000-fold lower than dose one here, where we're seeing equivalent levels of unsilencing. So this was, you know, really encouraging, and I think it also told us that the vector engineering and the vector components of the AAV really has the potential to meaningfully improve the efficiency and the target engagement with these microRNA candidates. What's also important to look at, and I think Allison just mentioned this in the previous slide, so that was a really helpful preview, is to understand the off-target profiling of these microRNA candidates. And that's true for any drug that interacts with DNA or RNA. And so what we wanted to look at here, this is a bit of a complicated slide, but what it shows is whole genome RNA sequencing. And so here, in each of these panels, you're looking at every single gene, the expression of every single gene in the human genome. We're doing this in human iPSC-derived neurons. And what we're looking for is to see that, one, our paternal UBE3A is shifting to the right, so it's up. We're upregulating UBE3A, and we're also interested in understanding what other genes we may be altering. So on the x-axis is fold change. So elements that shift to the right are upregulated. Elements that shift to the left are downregulated. And on the y-axis is just a p-value. So this is a level of significance, and it gives us a sense of the statistical power and at what level we feel that these types of changes are statistically meaningful. And so what we were really encouraged by is that these updated candidates not only show improved potency, but we also have the capacity to meaningfully improve upon the specificity profile of these microRNA candidates by making some of these genomic changes. Importantly, for all of these candidates, we do see paternal UBE3A shifting to the right, but not maternal, so that's encouraging. And we also see that an antisense gene that is close to our target sequence is being knocked down, but not a gene that's further upstream. So what do our next steps look like? Where do we take this from here? I've shown you that we have been able to identify a vectorized microRNA approach that's capable of upregulating UBE3A and correcting phenotypes in the mouse model. We've been able to discover Gen 1 candidates in vitro that show that this approach is translatable and can work both in human iPSC cells as well as in non-human primates. And now we have a good sense of what are the potency requirements that we need to accomplish in order to achieve a drug candidate. And so today we are now in the process of taking some of these updated candidates into non-human primate studies. There are still a number of steps that we need to go, and Allison described nicely, the different hurdles that we'll need to overcome before we have an IND. But we're encouraged by this approach, and I think it provides important proof of concept that vectorized microRNA approach has the potential to provide, a durable and stable way to restore expression of UBE3A for Angelman syndrome. Oops. So I do want to acknowledge the tremendous work of the team that's been working diligently on this project over the past couple of years. In particular, Sarika Pillay has spearheaded this effort over the last 2 years. She's here in the audience, so if you do see her today, please congratulate her. It's been really a tremendous collaboration and a true privilege to be able to work with all the folks at our Encoded team across these various domains of drug development. So with that, I'll pause and thank you for your time and attention.